it's my king. What it do, what it do. Happy Thursday, family. Happy Thursday. How do you do? How's everybody doing? Good, that's awesome. And if you're not good, that's just honest. But I promise you, by the Spirit of God, you will be better after our conversation today. I see the Hendo twins in the spirit, at least happy to be here. Yep, deep in Hunter. Hunter's deep, deep hunting. Goodwill deep hunting. There it is. That's the tag team. So, a lot of people are joining us or they're jumping on late. So, make sure you guys send the link out. There's quite a few people missing and a lot more new people that we need to be connecting with as well. So I've already sent the link to a few of my friends. I'd encourage you to send the link out to yours, because if you get your friends and I get my friends, then we can all be friends. You know what I'm saying? If you know, you know. It's okay. Don't trip. Let me see. Who else? Yeah. So I'm going to send to my guy. Yup. Let me cut my ringer off too, so. But yeah, I see you, TT. I'm sure Jelly's on the other side too, so welcome. And yeah, let's just talk a little bit. I'm excited. God is good. I'm excited because, you know, like I always say, perspective is everything. I believe it's a reference. Well, it was already a reference. Let's put it like that. Because Deep asked me, is that Outkast? When I said, I can get your friends, you can get your friends, I can get my friends, we can all be friends. It was already out there in the atmosphere for a while. But I believe that the Biggie Smalls video, I love it when you call me Big Papa, with P. Diddy specifically making that statement, you know, to two different groups. Like, you get your friends, I get my friends, we can all be friends. You know what I'm saying? So that's where I remember that coming from. But there you go, just for the record. And so, yeah, so we're, you know, just really want more people to take advantage of this forum. And I want us to be, you know, taking the time to invite people to this forum. So this is something that should be growing continually as we're connecting with our friends and other people. And I'm connected with my friends. And, you know, literally we're all becoming part of the family of God as we connect with each other. So it's a beautiful thing. And it should be something that we allow to spread through us and not just stop the buck to us. You know what I'm saying? And so please, and if Mama Kathy can join us, or Papa Daniel, or you know, Papa Chris, I'm just calling out parents' names as I get to meet the families here. Then please, you know, invite them as well. I know some people are at work, and I get that. There it is. So, actually, I'm gonna, before I even say anything more, we're going to take a few moments here. I want you to play Looking For You by Kirk Franklin, and we'll keep it right here on the camera. But we're going to send the link out to some of our friends and loved ones. I'm going to do the same.
To all my people in the struggle.
And then we'll be right back. God's forgotten about you. Keep it here.
Here's some pain medicine. Let's go. In your car, you at the house, on your job, be encouraged, boo. Come on.
Don't grows from a mighty long way. That's why we love you. Come on.
People that you send a link to, I think I hit about at least a good 15. I was just hitting them like, what's good, you know, little, all right. So if anybody can beat that, let me know, because I was sending them like with comments too, not just like, you know what I mean, each person had a little personalized boom boom, you know what I mean. You gotta draw them in, so I just need them to know. One more log on Brody. I don't think you send personalized messages to everybody on your Facebook contact. You can't just do a mass send out and call that like a quality send out. It has to be that personal touch, you know. Some people don't even read the group messages. They really don't. I talked to my friends. I had to learn that. They don't even read them. If it's personalized, like, all right. Oh, no, I can't repeat that online. Somebody might misunderstand. One more. Jerome, what's up, bro? Log on. All right, let's see here. All right, that's good enough. I think that's a good 17. And one more for a good perfect 18. Spirit, soul, and body, 18. Darren's asleep. What happened? Oh, he's so sweet. Oh, I was going to say, wake up in the name of the Lord. I was going to start praying. I didn't know. So she said he's so sweet. So you're blessed, brother. We were going to get that sleepy spirit off you if you needed it. But it's okay. We thank God that everybody's awake. And plus, it's like already the middle of the day there. So, you know what I mean? That would be really like nap time, I suppose, you know. But I misunderstood. So we're just going to get off of that all together. But praise God. I ain't sleeping. Just got out of, oh, yeah, for sure. Brazilian jiu-jitsu practice. That means his levels are spiked. Brazilian jiu-jitsu. Because he's training in martial arts right now. So that's amazing. I think Hunter's going to be joining shortly, so that's good, Hunter, for the soul. he laughed and he looked up, but I was really serious. You really should think about it. It will really help, sir. I think it would be awesome for you. Let's see. But you pray about it, meditate on it. I don't even want to know if it's just, but let me see. I want to, haha. Okay, good. See, that's all you need is a want to. Well, there's a want to, there's a way. Isn't that what it says? All right, Darren, it's all recorded in the chat room. There's evidence of his, even though he did put haha, so a lawyer might use that as a technicality to get him off of that, but he did say the words, I want to. That expresses desire, will, consent. I think we have enough two-thirds to clear this, okay? Damien, love you, brother. Welcome. So I'm glad you guys are having fun. That's amazing. It makes me happy when I hear laughter. Charity, oh my goodness. Hello. Good afternoon, probably where you are. So love you. That's awesome. Yay. Phenomenal. That's my favorite. Hi, Charity. Hello. All right. So you guys, let's jump in a little bit. I'm just excited. I love everybody. Hope you love me. And I'm pretty sure you do. So let's just keep flowing from there. And hopefully some of our other friends will jump on. Oh, there was one more person I didn't send it to. And I'm going to say, hey, where are you? And she's going to say, I'm at work. But I'm going to say, do what you normally do. Just log in and let me know you're there, and then I'll feel happy. All right. So I'm going to keep you long today, but I want to keep you long enough. That's my best saying, my best way of saying that. Any apostle that you know, especially from the inner city, has at least 5-point closing. So if you hear last thing, just at least wait for at least 4 more. You just have to give that grace. But I'm going to try to focus today and laser focus and lock this in, sort of land this baby, and we got to move forward. So, again, very excited to have you guys on, and I want you to continue to like, subscribe, and share. You should check out our website, divinefamily.org. Very excited about that, and there's so much more content to come and to be uploaded. We have hundreds of hours of content, if not more. And we've just been waiting to put things together. So now we have our secure platform whereby we can, you know, launch and unleash and unlock a lot of things that we've been holding on to. So I'm very excited about that. And Katie's been working diligently, you know, with Raina and different ones to put these things together. And so now it's just a matter of putting all the collaborations together and putting some of this stuff out. So look out, check out the website, look for just more content to come. Not just video content, but even some writings and teachings and different things that are just really going to begin to emerge. So make sure you're checking us out on the website and letting people know about it as well. Of course, if you want to email us, you can always do so at divinefamilyla@gmail.com. Questions, testimonies, challenges. We also have our text line. And so we'll be running these type of screens before the podcast, after the podcast, same thing on Sundays, before and after, so you can see some of the advertisements or advertisements that we're talking about. And there's much, much more to come. Really excited about that. So somebody said, laugh out loud, old school Baptist. And you know, see, I'm not sure what that's referring to, but, you know, I dig, huh? Let me see. What did he say? Oh, you could go old school Baptist and ask anyone if anyone will give you 5 minutes. Then just add all the minutes together. Oh my gosh. I grew up Baptist, so that's like really deep. Just like the little finger when you have to like excuse yourself from the room, you got to kind of bow and put the finger up. And then you walk out like a real like humble face too. And that's excuse me, I need to go in the restroom, or excuse me. Anyway, I love my Baptist people, it's all family. So I get to talk about them too. What's today as far as the day?
It's Thursday, day 1, 3, 2.
3, 2, got it. And there she is, Lala. See, I was waiting for her. That's really deep. All right, so we have a 1. So today is 1:32, if you count from January 1st. Until the present day. So you have a 1, and you have a 2 and a 3. That's the whole Godhead right there. 1, 2, 3, even though it's 1, 3, 2. And then you have 32 is a 4 and an 8. If you multiply, that's a 4 and an 8. But if you add a 4 and an 8, that's 12. And that's interesting because today is the 12th. And so I was just thinking about the date today, just meditating on the symbols, not like just looking at the symbols. Today's the 12th. And so 12 in scripture, let me ask you guys, what does 12 symbolize in scripture? Put it in the chat room. From what we've talked about over time, what does 12 symbolize? Don't all chat at one time, please. Just, no. As some of you guys are thinking right now, that's fine. I'll give you some Jeopardy time. Do, 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 do. All right, good job. We got some answers on the board here. And let's see what we have on the board. Life is service says government. Deep says tribe. Raina says divine government. Carolina says order. Katie says perfect judgment. Now we are checking with the judges on those answers here. So just 1 second. Okay. All right. So we have some direction here now. So again, I like to try for the purposes of teaching to pull like really technical answers so we can remember it that way. But since we're teaching and this is grace training as well, you know, we will give some credit where some credit is due. So life is service, answer of government, it would be not fully correct, but there is some truth in that answer. Tribe, absolutely. In the sense of the Old Testament and the 12 tribes, but why was it 12 tribes would be my next question if the answer was tribe, because I still want to dig into why 12 tribes, why the 12, what did that 12 speak to? You know what I'm saying? Order is true, just like government. Both of those answers are true, but Raina's answer would be sort of the more full, you know, divine government, right? Or divine governance, right? So to that point, that is why there were 12 tribes or 12 apostles. You know what I mean? Even as I mentioned before, to the point that when Judas hung himself, that they had to replace his spot. Because 11, even though 11 does have some good attributes to it, you know, when you study it out in deeper terms, in one sense, it does speak to incomplete governance, which is why the 12th spot had to be filled. Now, they cast lots and it went to Matthias as opposed to Barnabas. But Barnabas, I mean, Matthias. But really, God's choice in the spirit was Barnabas, because you don't even hear about Matthias anymore in scripture after that. But Barnabas, you hear about a lot, and he actually worked with Paul. So sometimes, you know, man, you know, does the best they can, or they use human methods to choose, because casting lots is kind of like shooting dice. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, it's this crapshoot. But, or casting straws or whatever. But Nathaniel in the Gospels is the same person as Barnabas in the book of Acts. You can look it up and see it's true. Welcome, Jesse. We love you so much. So I'll look at the numbers later, but I was just sort of looking at 132. But today is May 12th. And so May, I told you, is what? The month of power and permission. Or I'll say permission and power. Because if I ask, if I'm in class and I ask Teacher Katie, may I use the restroom? Right? And then she says, what? Yes, you may. So first I requested permission. And then with that, yes, I received authorization. I received authority to go. Are you hearing me? So May is the month of, in my mind, of permission and power. But it's also, today is the 12th. So today would be, you know, the meshing of divine governance in the month of permission and power. And I think it's very prophetic. And today is Thor's day. If you've ever watched our teaching on the days of the week, which I did on one of our previous podcasts, you'll have to go back and research. I'm not sure which date it was, but we talked about the days of the week and essentially how they, our English days of the week, all correlate with, you know, from the system it comes from worship of different gods, Saturn day and the worship of the sun, Sunday and moon day, Monday and Tuesday had to do with the god of Mars, and Wednesday is Odin's day, and then Thursday is Thor's day. Thor's day, Thor is the son of Odin. Odin is another term for God. And so I believe it was the Greek god, you know, Odin. But Odin is a term for God, I believe, in the Norse. And so Odin's day would be like God's day, and then Thor's day would be the son of God the day after Wednesday, right? So Thor, in a picture, it represents the son of God, right? So today is almost like another day for the son of God. So it's like, so you have the Sunday, the S-O-N, on the day of divine governance. And he, and the Bible says in the book of Isaiah that for unto us a child is born, and unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders, and his name shall be called Emmanuel, which means God with us, and of the increase of his kingdom and peace there will be no end. But the government will be upon his shoulders. See that? It says that in Isaiah, I believe it's chapter 9. And so that's speaking of that divine governance. That there are different numbers in the scripture that are very significant for different reasons, but 12 is you know, one of them. And I could say more about that, but the more, man, some of my spelling in my notes is really deep. It's like really Ebonic-like, and I'm just having to, I'm looking at these notes here like, whoa, you're really writing fast there. But let me just get this out. I digress. Today is May 12th, 2022. So when I break each thing down, okay, tell me what 5 represents. And it could be at least 2 things that we've talked about frequently with the number 5. Now, Raina, while everybody's giving their chats real quick, take me off for 1 second. I'm be right back. And then you guys are going to, we're going to read your answers and go from there. All right, so she gave you a much better version of the Jeopardy music than I did, so I just have to acknowledge that and say thank you, Ray. Let's see what some of these answers are here. Let's see. We've got grace, and apostolic grace. Lots of grace there, huh? You guys just gracing each other out, huh? All right, so next time more people get in there, you know what I mean? Tell us what you think. It's really good for your training. don't be afraid to be wrong, because God wants you to be right. And so have courage, take a shot. You'll learn at the end of it all either way. That's the goal, right? So have fun with it. The question was the number five. What does it symbolize? And so we have grace. You can still answer if you're thinking, but go ahead and jump in there. Apostolic grace. Yes, what does the number five symbolize? That was the question. Welcome, Edwina. We love you. Bam. So Katie's answer is good. It's really solid. I mean, Nami and Deep, that's correct. But again, my question was, and then Jesse now says, that's what I thought, Raina. Why didn't you say something, Jesse? I love you. Come on. Jump in there. And then Raina shows the muscle emoji. Come on. She needs to jump in there with you. It's okay to say it twice. It's okay. Jump in there. Well, okay. So usually a lot of things that you only think of, that's the Holy Spirit saying, this is the answer. Say it. Say it. So jump out there, Jay. All right. For sure. Apostolic is the fivefold ministry. Laugh out loud. No laugh out loud. That's true. No laugh out loud. So five, yes, because my question was what, and I mentioned at least two things that we've talked about, and so those two things are included here. We have this idea of it being the number of grace, but we also have this idea that it's the speaking of the hand of God, and specifically the apostolic, because the apostle can touch the other four, right? And so it's the fivefold ministry, but of course, apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher, right? And so, and then like one prophet said, the teacher is the smallest finger, but it can get into the ear and get, you know, and get into certain places where the other fingers can't. Think about that. The pastor is the ring finger because they're married to the church. The evangelist is the longest finger because it's the most far reaching. The index finger points and gives direction. That's the prophetic. And the thumb, you need to grab. For me to grab this pen, I'm using my thumb for sure, you know? You use your thumb to touch everything because it touches all the other four. So that's just a snapshot of the five. But yes, five, the number of grace. And that's why I told you the number of 25 is five times five. That's grace upon grace. And the Bible says about Jesus, and of his fullness have we received, and grace for grace, or grace upon grace. So even that's indicating 25. Wow, that's interesting. I've never heard that, but I'll have to think about that before I say it out loud. That's pretty intense. If there are dimensions to the five, never mind. That's too much. Let me just sit on it. 12. So now we have five, speaking about the fivefold ministry, which was mentioned, or the apostolic, you know, and also grace. So that's why I said apostolic grace is a really good answer. But for the purpose of explaining, we had to break that out. We actually have more than five senses. And I need to brush up on that so we can teach on it a different time. But we actually have more than five. But and there's far more in the spirit as well, too. But let's just say that there are like intuition, perception. There are different things that are actually, there's a more nuanced range of senses that we have now access to, or that we know consciously that are there. I will do a teaching on that at a different moment. But we know there's at least five, but I believe there's far more. Now, so I can finish the date and talk about what I want to talk about. Hallelujah. And it's 10:22, interesting enough. Is that 22 is what? Does anybody remember when we talked about 22? Put it in the chat room. Especially when we started at the beginning of the year, I was literally going through every number. And when we got to 22, I took some dedicated time. It came up again in a special event that I preached on and prophesied the outcome ahead of time. We talked about the number 22 and what it symbolizes. And so I see we have one answer so far. I'm going to give a couple more moments. Would you drop that beat for a few seconds, Raina, while the folks give their answers here? I'm looking for at least two things. At least two things. All right. Anybody else going to get in there? Anyone else? The number 22. It's a good reason for you guys to go back and watch some of the prior casts so you can, you know, just because we hear it one time doesn't mean that we receive it. That meditation involves repetition of study and thought and, you know, just giving yourself time to get into it. So let's see. Union of the two houses, union of the human and spirit. I think you guys are giving some really rich answers that maybe by prophetic extension and application, I think could absolutely apply. But in terms of the literal training that we gave on these subjects, Teacher Nami would have the award here. I asked for at least two things, or I mentioned that there was at least two things. And so we talked about that number 22, specifically, right? And from the Hebrew alphabet, how, from what I understand, there are 22 letters that comprise the Hebrew alphabet. Of course, in our English language, we have 26, right? They have 22, from what I understand. And so, and of course, it has a picture of something, and then there's a letter, and then there's a sound, and there's like three things that correlate in their alphabet. But in this case, 22 would symbolize, if it were their entire alphabet, just like for Americans or English-speaking folks, 26 would symbolize the fullness of its alphabet code. Or so, yes, by it's by 22 in the Hebrew thought would be the fullness of the Word of God, because all of the Word of God would be made up of those 22 variations of those combinations of those letters, right? And it also, if it speaks of the Word of God or the fullness of the Word of God, then it also has to speak of light, because the Bible says in Psalms, what? Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. And God himself is light. So even though Katie's answer, I think if you were to study it out, a lot of people would accept that answer too. And I think because there are different sort of, each number can have a range of what it means. But I believe that two being the number of the sun, you know what I mean? And then you have 22, even speaking of like a double honor. And so, yes, I know it's double 11. And so some people would actually say it would be double chaos. But I don't really feel that in my spirit right now, or that that's what we're highlighting. Perhaps in a different discussion, in a different nuanced point that the Spirit would want to make, we could highlight the truth of the other side of 22, if that is even included. But from everything that I began to look into and study on, it was very much a good number, and I've been calling this year the year of light and the year of the full. Let me just read what I got in my notes, even, because I think this is part of it's a repeat, but some of you never heard it. So 5/12/22, the month of permission and power, divine governance, year of light, or the manifestation of God's full or seasoned or matured or aged word. Sometimes when it comes to wine, you want to let it age, right? Certain wines age better with time, right? But then when that time comes for that occasion, it's time to uncork the wine, pop bottles, and celebrate. Wine speaks of joy. So when God says he's bringing us new wine, that's also speaking about new sources and dimensions of joy that will compare whatever you call joy before that to not even look like joy because of the newness of this wine and this joy, you know? And so when I say an aged word, I think about a mess age. I've talked about an aged mess. And so what I felt in my spirit is like even all the things we've been seeing, from the children to the crashing of the economy to the masking of society and the masking of the prophets and all these, the shutting down of churches and various places that are, you know, I mean, all these things that have been happening, it's been an absolute mess. But the mess age of God is now coming forth. That is really powerful. You're going to have to just chew on it. I don't have too much time to explain it. Just a couple of little current event things real quick that I felt like I wanted to mention that were just of significance in terms of events that happened to me. Like one of them was interesting. I know some, most of you guys heard about that Dave Chappelle you know, the video where he got attacked on stage. And I read that the attorney, the what is it? The Gascon, that guy, he said no charges to be filed against that guy. I was shocked. I was like, what? No charges? He tackled the guy. He had a knife. It's a gun knife. It was a gun, but it pulls out into a knife. So it wasn't really a gun, but it looks like a gun, but it was a knife. So he had that on his person. And then he came out and said, well, because he didn't use it, no charges filed on that note. So I'm like, isn't that like saying if you found a bomber full of a bag of grenades, but they didn't set them off, that there should be no, you get what I'm saying? Anyway, the city attorney of LA was like, nah, we can't let them go with no charges. People are going to go riot. So they gave him like two misdemeanors. But it's just exactly, it's just really a sign of the moment we're in. Even though things are about to transition, there's about to be a, remember the musical chairs came where you play the music and then everybody has to walk around the chairs and then they stop. You're about to see some chairs eliminated. I can already hear the music playing, but you're about to see some chairs eliminated and some other folks replaced. But yeah, that was scratching my head. And then I was just, you know, there's just different things, you know. There's a lot of things out there. I'm not really trying to make a judgment about individual groups. I'm just talking about current events that have been in the news cycle already, and I'm just kind of commenting on some of them, you know. Like there's a male who turned female, and he was a swimmer as a male and continues as a female now. But as a male swimmer, he was like 457th. Amongst his fellow male competitors in the ranking of swimming. But immediately when he turned over to go into becoming a female or identifying as a female, he continued to, or I guess he would say she now or whatever, continued to compete in swimming and won like the first two championships, like got the championship because, you know, competing against females and he's got all the male stuff, you know. And it's just all these things that are happening, because I even saw that same thing. I watched it bothered me so much, but I watched the, how do I turn that off? But I watched the MMA fight, and it was between a born female and a born male turned female. I'll just say it that way, trying to, you know, speak on these levels, right? And as I watched the fight, it was clear that the female, born female, was much more skilled at her craft than the male turned female. And the girl, how do I turn it? Let's see. How do I turn this off? Help me. It's just on the, it's like text messages coming in really loud too. How do I turn it? Oh my God. Oh my God. Yeah, how do I do that? Yeah, just 1 second, but I'm going to keep talking while I do that, but I'm going to turn the camera off. So I can't remember the girl's name, but the male turned female, her name was Alana. So Alana was getting beat up the entire fight, thank you. And the first round, she was getting beat up by the female. The female was like using her boxing skills and like really, you know what I'm saying, dropping jabs and she just didn't know what to do, Alana. And but she was still had all the attributes of a male, you know. So even though the girl was giving her best work, I mean, she was tagging her up. She even knocked her down at one time. She got back up, and she was still able to endure those punches. And then by the time it came to round two, she had gassed herself out, the female, born female, trying to compete against this male. And then the male basically got like one shot to her head, and you see the girl like grab her head during the fight, like this is not a normal, you know, like I've been fighting for years, I've never taken a shot like this, you know. So then she kind of grabs her head, and then the guy Alana gets on top of her, wrestles her to the ground, and then like punches her out, or then they, you know, she taps out or whatever, or she puts her out. I forgot which one, but it was just like very disturbing, because in any other context, that would be assault. That would be abuse. That would be, and it's stemming from spirits that are being released into the atmosphere, trying to blur the lines of our divine design. You know what I'm saying? It's not about not accepting people or not loving people, but you don't, you shouldn't be forced to love and accept people at the expense of truth and just basic biology and medicine and science and things that are provable and knowable and testable and discernible. And you know what I mean? It's not about not being accepted, but, you know, there's just things that are just not, there's clear physical differences between men and women, you know what I mean? Which is why they have like the WNBA and the NBA, or, you know what I mean? There's just people who understand science and medicine and design. They're setting up context for things so everybody can thrive in their context, you know what I mean? And so you have these things happening. There's another female, a male, born male, wanting to turn female at age 30. So for 30 years, they've been doing physical activity, sports, developing their testosterone, muscle, and now at age 30, they want to go over to female MMA. So now they're going up against all the champions who are born female, and they're rightfully earning their spot to win those championships, and this person comes in dominating them. Even though they're not a better fighter, they just had heavier hands because they were actually getting punched up, and one girl actually beat the guy, which is great. But not before he took a couple of girls' belts who legitimately, you know what I mean? And I think it actually went to the Supreme Court, and there's a whole thing behind it, because it's a big thing right now that's happening. A lot of people that maybe aren't as successful as they wanted to be on the male side are going over to become females. It's happening in was another sport too, swimming. But, yeah, there's different sports where it's happening. And it's just like there's just certain things, you know, that are out of pocket. I know that there may be different feelings on this next thing I bring up, but I believe there was a vote that went 49-51 against abortion becoming federalized in the Constitution. And a lot of people, you know, feel good about that because we want to protect the rights for babies to have, you know, to come alive, you know, to become alive. And I know that there are different feelings on that. And if you want to say that something about it, you can, but we have to protect those who can't protect themselves. That's what the whole thing about the God of justice and the God of the oppressed and the God of the widow and the God of the afflicted and the God of the, you know what I mean? There's people out there in society, from babies who haven't even had the chance to come to be, to other people, seniors and people who are abused and bullied and preyed upon. And we have to protect every aspect of life for all of the levels of life that God desires to bring forth in the earth. You know what I mean? So there's just, you know, I know there's a lot I can say about that, but I just really wanted to at least put that part out there. These are just some things I've been looking at in the news, and I thought were worthy of mention. Now, I'm only going to keep you for a little bit longer here, but I want to share. I feel like the Holy Spirit is helping me to teach you guys even better each time by slowing down, because my gift can go a million miles in a million different directions all in 1 minute. And I see sometimes, like, if you see the cartoon and it's like the hair is standing straight up and the eyes are like popping out of the head, you know, it's like, what just happened? Like, I know. So I'm learning how to slow down too, as well as speed up. And so I'm going to go back to something we talked about a little bit, just the scripture. And I'm going to give a different application. So you can post the scripture for me, team. I thank my teammates who helped me so much with that kind of stuff. But in Isaiah, he says what? Who shall believe our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? And I'm so glad that I see many of the faces on here who are on here, because many of you were in my heart, honestly, as I was getting this word. So the fact that you're able to at least consume it in real time is awesome. And I pray that others will be able to come on later and watch it, you know, in their time. But and Hunter, I'm glad you're on too as well, because I wanted to share, I feel like this will bless you as well, to tell her to log on. People are saying hi, log on so you can get blessed. This will help you. Does anybody want to be helped today? Okay. So I'm going to take you back in time in my life. And I've shared this before, but it's been quite some time. So I'm sure most of you have never heard it and some of you don't remember it. But as a child, I used to experience a lot of visions. But especially two visions on a very, very regular basis. And it wasn't just two visions on a very, very regular basis anywhere. It was always, always. I mean, I can't think of a time where it wasn't. It was always two visions at the same time, like back to back, meaning back to back, but always in the same location. And that location being the restroom. Don't ask me why. I don't have a deep revelation behind that yet. All I know is that it would always happen where? In the restroom. And so I'm going to share briefly those two visions, and then I'm going to tie it to the scripture I just laid out in Isaiah. Or Isaiah. Turn with me to Isaiah. Capitulo. Okay, anyway. So, always in the restroom. But the first set of visions, or the first vision would be, I would say, a beautiful vision, a powerful vision, an encouraging vision. And that vision, all the time, often, I'm just doing my best to describe my experience, but maybe you will be able to identify it with your own or just listen and perceive. But it's almost like if there was four corners to the room, right, in any room, right, then all four corners had like these voices, angelic voices, voices coming out, cheering me on. Run your race. Go, man of God. You know, like you're going to be great. You know, just like I'm just like, woo, we're going to do this for God. You know, I'm, as a young kid, I'm excited to serve Jesus. I know, man, I was put here for a purpose. I was made for greatness, and we're going to know all the details yet. But, man, I feel super encouraged. I'm ready to run through a wall for my God right now just based on this encouragement that's coming in the room. You know what I'm saying? Let's get it. What is it? I don't even know, but I'm excited for Jesus. I want to be great. God's going to, you know what I'm saying? It's going to be awesome. God's going to use me. My life is it's literally. That's okay. It's literally, even as a kid, before I ever read the scripture, I was experiencing the scripture. That's why I'm telling you, to some of you guys, don't discount time in your life that wasn't church time or religious time or self quote God time, because God was still working. God is not religious. You're going to have to chew on that. I don't have time. But I began to experience this scripture before I ever read the scripture and knew it was a scripture. Hebrews 12:1, that wherefore seeing we also are surrounded, are encompassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin, which is the unbelief or forfeiting the high call but living at a lower call, that does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher, who for the joy that was set before him endured his cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. So the first part, especially verse 1, wherefore seeing we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses. I remember one day in my life, just going forward for a second, back as an adult, young adult, I used to run with even some of the people in the house. I used to run. We used to just run like miles from where we lived in the Culver City area. We'd run to the marina, about 4 miles there and back. And we would run on a regular basis. And I remember this one day, this is before I had started running on a regular basis at all, that I was just so frustrated with my life. And I couldn't just sit in my room. I couldn't just sit in my house. I would just needed to do something, You know what I mean? And I just literally got up and I ran 6 miles without training, and like halfway through, it was the same feeling that I'm describing to you now that I had as a kid. It was that same feeling that literally from all the different corners, the encouragement was coming, run your race, man of God, run. I could receive supernatural strength to run 6 miles, and I hadn't even trained to run one at that time. That might have even been a catalyst to get me to start running. But it was that same type of surround sound angelic encouragement. I had my own divine THX. If you go to the movie and it says, THX, the audience is listening. I became aware from a young age that there was an audience always listening, always watching, almost in anticipation for what I was going to become. Can you hear me? This is what I begin to experience all the time as a kid. But let me finish my thought. Because immediately after that, and I mean immediately, was a whole different vision, a whole different vision. In the second vision, I would see myself sad, alone, sometimes homeless, which means hungry and thirsty and without a roof over my head, without a family, depressed, dark, suicidal even. Do you understand? This happened to me all the time as a kid. I'm not even sure if I ever told my parents, nor if I did what I thought they would have believed me or understood me perhaps. But I experienced it all the time and always back to back. The exhilarating joy of, that's what he means in Jeremiah 29 when he says, for I know the plans I have for you. Plans to prosper you and bless you and increase you, bring you to your purpose and your call. And he says to bring you to a expected end. Every child born to the earth has that hope in their heart until it's suffocated from them, or stifled, or snatched through an abusive guardian or a person of influence in their life, being used by the enemy to sow seeds of discouragement for an unexpected end. But the first set of visions was clearly of the Lord, right? Clearly of God, clearly being inspired by the Spirit to encourage my soul and my faith to believe and move forward and grace forward and grow forward with this expectancy that life is going to be good for me. But immediately afterwards, always the negative side, homeless, lonely, sad, no family, no friends, depressed, suicidal. Do you understand? Are you with me? So now I'm connecting that back to Isaiah 53:1, because God asks the question to each person listening, the same question. Who has believed our report? There were clearly two reports being given. One was clearly from God, and one was clearly not. But when I'm a young child, without a trainer, without a parent, without a guide, without a life coach, without a mentor to guide me into this realm of the Spirit, then you may think that everything you see is authenticated, and maybe both visions are true. Maybe it's good for a while, and then it goes the other way. No one was there to explain it to me, nor did I have the courage to necessarily share the impressions I kept getting. But I'm telling you now, as I'm talking to you about this scripture, whose report will you believe? There's a gospel song that we sing. Whose report will you believe? We shall believe the report of the Lord. Whose report will you believe? We shall believe the report of the Lord. His report says I am free. His report says victory. His report. I'm doing the lyrics out of line, out of order, but that's the basic feel of it. It's singing that song in scripture, a scripture in a song. Whose report will you believe? That's the call. And then the response is, we shall believe the report of the Lord, right? Because I had to make a choice as a kid. Which report was I going to believe? And if I'm being honest, at first I believed the wrong report. I began to experience those type of things in my life. Lack, loss of friends, impoverished types of situations, though I'm not saying that I was like in abject poverty as many others. I'm not comparing. I'm just saying compared to where I was in life and where my circle, you know, other kids had the Jordans and the fancy shoes. And we just, you know, we took what we got until I got to an age where I can get a job and start buying what I want. I started working at 13. Because it was that important to me to be able to provide the type of image that I thought was important for me to provide. So I thought your dress code and how you carry yourself is so important. And I began to fight against that anti-faith in Christ, you know, anti-God vision by putting muscles in place to not produce that reality. Does that make sense? I'm saying it wasn't until I met my apostle and years after years of encouragement that I began to believe that God is good and he would actually loves me. I mean, I believe that God is good because the Bible tells us that. And I believe that God is good because it lines up with my theology. But I wasn't so sure that God was good to me. Maybe my lot in life was to just suffer and help other people get to their place of goodness. And maybe I'll just get my reward later. Maybe this is my repayment for all the things that the way I live before I live for the Lord. You know, maybe this is my karma. Come on. Maybe this is my harvest. And the Lord had to really heal me and had to unlearn a lot of things that I grew up. I picked up along the way growing up in churchianity. You know, I told you at my old church, God bless them, but the prayer list always grew longer and longer. And for every 9 out of 10 people that was on that prayer list, the only time they came off was when they passed away. You might see 1 or 2 recover, maybe 8 out of 10. Maybe 1 or 2 would recover for a while. Then they'd go home. And I thought, wow, is he really a healer or not? Keeps growing until they start going. Then it shrinks. But it's like, what's going on? And then they taught me that the more poor you were, the more humble you were, the more you were, and the more sickness you carried in your body, the more you were suffering for God's glory. So suffer well. But then when I started reading the scripture, he said, he was wounded for my transgressions. He was bruised for my iniquities. The scourging, the chastening of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, I were healed. I say it that way on purpose. And by his stripes, we were healed. I said, oh, that's different than what they're teaching me. I've got to go with the word of God. So I'm in 5th grade. I said, oh, you mean my eyesight's going bad, but I don't want to wear glasses. You mean I could stand on the word of God? And so every night, I just lay hands on my eyes and said, Lord, I don't want glasses. Your word says, by your stripes, I were healed. So I declare that over my life. I will not wear glasses. I will have perfect vision. According to your word, be it unto me. And I would just go to sleep. And every night, I'd still see blurry, be doing my homework sometimes, blurry vision. I was like, nope. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with wearing glasses. I'm not trying to make a judgment about people who do. But that's not for me. I will not wear glasses. I will have perfect sight. And your word says, by your stripes, I were healed. I'm going to stand on that. Good night. And I go to bed. And I don't even remember the day it changed, because most of my prayers that I can recall being answered in my life, I couldn't tell you the day I prayed it, and I couldn't tell you the day he answered it. Somewhere along the way, when I looked up, the tomb was empty. Somewhere along the way, I looked up and that pain was gone off of my heart. I don't require him to give me a date when he's going to do what he does. I just make my request with thanksgiving and let him do what he does. And while he's doing what he's supposed to do, I'm doing what I'm going to do and serve him, align with him, feed his sheep, care for his lambs, pour into his house, give my life to him, and let him worry about that. I lay that request at his feet for a reason, because I knew he had the power to deal with that for me. So I'm not going to micromanage it. Most of the prayers that I have tried to micromanage, those are the ones I haven't seen the answer to, or it caused delays. But when I leave it at his feet and I go about my business, and I look up and I'm like, whoa, it's gone. I'm free. Fear is lifted. Where's depression? Where's self-pity? You know, I'm saying these things for a reason, because we need to discover the anatomy of God. The Bible tells you in 1 John, Brother Hunter, and to different ones, test the spirits by the spirits to see whether they are of God or not. God needs our brain and our spirit to align. But you may need to pray in the spirit regularly as a lifestyle to help bring your brain under alignment. But God still, he doesn't throw away your brain. He sanctifies your brain so that things that your brain would tell you not to do, yeah, that's called logic. You know, the spirit and the brain need to work together, not to fight each other. But the Bible does say in Romans 8 that the carnal mind is an enemy of God, because it is not subject to God, neither indeed can it be. That's why he told you those who are in the flesh cannot please God, because the carnal mind is an enemy of God. But the spiritual-minded person, the Bible says, is life and peace. So as I've said many times before, he wants it all to work together. If things are inspiring you to feel intimidated and terrorized and panic, that is a pretty good indicator that it's not from God, because even God's correction comes with love, which will lead you to repentance. So there, that's what I'm talking about when I say the anatomy of God. You can't just run with every emotion you experience. You can't just listen to every voice you hear. You must test the spirit by the spirit. And how do you do that? By knowing the word of God, because the spirit confirms the word. The Bible says in Matthew 28, and the Lord went with them and confirmed the word, working with them and confirming the word with signs following. But when you go back and read it, the word them is italicized, which means it was added by the translators for clarity. So if you read it without the them, it says the Lord went with, confirming his word. That he only went with them to the degree that they went with his word. Can you hear me? That the translators added them, but the original says that he went with his word, confirming his word, working his word. So to the degree that they had his word is to the degree that he went with them. Can you hear me? Because it's the word of God that's quick and powerful, sharper than any double-edged sword, piercing to the dividing asunder of soul and spirits, of joints and marrow. It's a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. And neither is there any creature not made manifest before the eyes of him with whom we have to do, but all things are open and naked before the eyes of him with whom we have to do. So that's the time that we're in. We're in a time of great exposure. There'll be many oohs and ahs and shocks, and people will be discouraged on some levels by the things that are unfoiled, the names and the people and celebrity and people that we idolize, and that's why we got to get back to our first love. This is a time for us to return to our first love, and for some of us it's a time to turn to our first love for the first time, but maybe for others it's a time to return to our first love. You really have to put him in his position in your life if you want to see the truth of his word flowing forth in your life. You have to lay down your ambition for a relationship, your ambition for a position, your ambition to be seen or known or heard or whatever your cup of tea is, for his hit, for him to have that first position. Seek first the kingdom of God. What else? And his what? Righteousness. His right way of seeing things, viewing the world, understanding even natural events that we have really strong opinions about that sometimes stifle the word of God from being able to be revealed to us, you know? And so everything about my life has been, is being dipped into him. Everything, every thought process, every opinion. Baptism wasn't a one-time event. That was the first fruit of a daily washing. That when you take a shower and when you take a bath, God even designed those things to be a picture of your daily washing, of a daily spiritual cleansing, of a daily spiritual renewal, of a daily spiritual refreshing, of a daily spiritual rejuvenation that the whole creation declares his glory, even baths and showers. It was to give us a picture of going under, you know. I always go under, you know, and when I come up, I was like, I baptize myself afresh to your service, to your purpose for today, for your attitude to flow through me, for your love to be readily available to flow through me, for your personality to flow through me. You know, I take a dip because it's a reminder that I've gone under, and as I come up, I come again in that newness of life. Or as I go under the waterfall, so to speak, of the shower head, the head showers me with fresh water. The shower head, Lord of the shower head, the God of the shower head, he showers me afresh with running water, rivers of water flowing down over me, his Niagara Falls flowing over me. All of your billows and waves have gone over me. You see, that probably was an impetus for the showerhead creation. All of your billows and waves have gone over me. You wash over me with your word. And so this is why we take time each time to dig into the word, because God wants us to have a successful life. And a successful life is not, oh, look how mightily you were used today on the broad pod, or look how God spoke through you. He wants us to have a successful, healthy mind space. You live in this space. I remember my apostle, when I was especially young and even growing, he was like, wow, I'd hate to be you. What am I saying by saying that? Because he had the spiritual capacity to search a person, to go inside of you and search you in the spirit. And I, there would be times where I could feel him like, oh man, he's like, oh man, he's, you know, he's searching me, you know, and he's like, and so that was a statement. It wasn't that he was saying anything about my natural person, or it was saying the mental space that I live in is such a chaotic world, and it would be hard for him to be able to thrive in that space. But he didn't leave me in that space. He helped me come into a better headspace. Because the battlefield is the mind, saints. Can you hear me, Hunter? The battlefield is our mind. So we need to saturate our minds with the words of God. And I don't just mean the Bible. I mean even prophetic words that have been spoken over you. The Bible says that you're to remind yourself of the various words that God has spoken over you and do warfare with them. Because usually when God gives you words, it oftentimes, now naturally, he's telling you things that are coming, but sometimes he's telling you that word because you're about to enter into a season of contradiction where it looks like in your life situation and circumstance, the bipolar opposite of what he just said. Just like Jesus, he got baptized by John in the River Jordan, and then what happened? The heavens opened, a portal came down and said, "This is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased, hear him." And then immediately he fasted for 40 days and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. And then what did he say? The enemy's first words, what? What did he say, family? What were the enemy's first words to the Lord when he was getting tempted by the devil, you know, in his temptations, the three temptations? Can anybody tell me what his first words were to Jesus? You guys are adding a word. Yes. He didn't say if you are really. He just said if you are. Right? He didn't say really like, we know you are, but just to prove it. No, he said, if you are, prove it. Good job, Hunter. I said deep, but they both did it. Good job. They had it right, but just that word really See, sometimes in our English language, we water things down. And I believe in the kingdom of God, there are absolutes. Do you love me, Lord? Yes. Would you ever leave me nor forsake me? No. Will you heal me? Yes, right? But in our watered down language, we say, are you coming over? Probably. Are you going to go to the thing today? Maybe. Most likely. See, we in our language today, we would say it like this. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whosoever believes in him will most likely not die, but probably have eternal life. That's how we talk. But there are clear absolutes in God. Now, there's a difference between you looking at something prophetically and you're zooming in more and more and you're like not trying to speak like you have the full picture. That the heart of that is different. But I'm just saying that we need to be more clear and resolute in some of our conversation and definite and move a little bit away from this flimsiness of PC-ness, which probably, most likely, possibly, it leaves wiggle room. Hallelujah. And that's the truth being dropped on you. Glory to God. And so if you are the Son, then turn these stones into bread. See that? Now, God had already said, this is my beloved Son. But the enemy understood this principle. If he could have gotten Jesus to question his number one, I talked about these three things. Does anybody remember the three things? Your blank, your blank, and your blank. It's like this order of progression of first, it's this most important one. Then the second thing is a result of the first discovery. And then the third thing is, yes, that is the first one, Jesse. Good job. So that's what I'm saying. We'll pause there and get the, and that's the second one. Go ahead, finish it off now. She's got the Jeopardy board here. She's got this thing on lock. That was the Daily Double. She's getting it. What's the last one? Oh, wait, let's see. Oh, no. I love you so much. That last one, let's help her out. She's got two out of the three. Does anybody remember? She gave you the first two. So I'll start talking about this first one while she's doing that, while you guys are answering that. Identity. If he could have got Jesus to question his identity, he went right away directly against the very thing that God confirmed when the Spirit came upon him like a dove. This is my beloved Son, because he was really talking about the Spirit of sonship that came upon him, authenticating him as a Son of God. Nope, you're mixing something else. So here we go. So identity is who you are at your core. Identity. Your purpose is what you're called to do based on who you be or who you are being, who you are being. And the last thing is prosperity or finances. But I like prosperity more because it includes finances, but it's not limited to finances. And I like to define that as the resources that you need to accomplish your purpose based on your identity. So you see how everyone is progressively builds upon the other. So again, if the enemy could have gotten Jesus to question his identity, then of course he would have forfeited his purpose and the prosperity attached to his purpose. Your prosperity, your provisions are for the battle. The financial success that you seek is attached to your purpose, which is attached to your identity. So the enemy will fight you tooth and nail on number one to completely stop you from getting to number two and three. And that's the order of how the fight goes. Many people never get past number one. Especially in this hour where they're taking the right to number one before they even come out the womb. But God's going to put a stop to that, even as the last god to be destroyed in Egypt was Baal Zephon, which was that god they were sacrificing to and killing those babies. And please understand, for some of you who think that we're talking on a political level, you have no clue. You have no clue the spiritual connections to these things that are happening. There is clear Luciferian worship involved with these type of activities that we're talking about. And we can go into that more at a different space. But clearly, you think this is just a political fight about rights and all that. This is not. It's totally demonic. It always has been. And those same spirits of old are trying to rear their ugly heads at this time and come forth again. That's why King Solomon said, you know, nothing is really new under the sun. That which was before will be again. You know what I mean? It might be a new variation. It might be a 2.0. It might be a little different face on it, but it's the same spirit. It's the same heart. It's the same root systems trying to manifest the kingdom of darkness through diverse means. So I don't, you know, we can go into more of that, but I want us to just continue to dig in. You know, Hunter, I want you to be watching these podcasts. You can go all the way back and train with, you know, Pastor Darren and Katie. You know, guys, you guys get together and pray, because you really need to get into the Word so we can and be walking with the Holy Spirit. Remember what I said, the Word is the person of God first and the book second. And so I'm not saying just go and get all trapped up in the book, because you now you have more confusion, because some of our minds, they work certain ways. You know what I mean? Some of you guys, and that's what I felt to tell you, like even for you, Hunter, I felt like a slow down and smell the roses. Take one day at a time, because sometimes we get this like these spurts, you know, these emotional spurts. You know what I mean? Where like you just feel this burst of God. You're like, oh, my God, I just want to do everything for God. You know what? I'm going to stop eating. I'm going to stop drinking. I'm going to stop showering. I'm going to stop whatever. You know what I mean? You just go on this like crazy like binge, God binge, or the other way into the world. You're like, I'm so sick of this. I'm going to go the other way and just drink until for days and go into, you know, excess, because we're constantly going in and out of different psychological states of being. That's a whole nother message for a different time. But that's why being able to identify where you are is such an important commodity, because if you know where your location is, then you can know how to get where you want to be. And so sometimes when we numb ourselves through different means, it blurs our ability to rightly discern where we are and what we need. And even if we do know where we are, God wants to replace some of our go-tos. Hallelujah. Because the Holy Spirit says some of us go to the drink or go to the bottle or go to the sex or go to certain drugs. And it's different drugs, different people. It doesn't have to be what everybody in society calls drugs. Sometimes drugs is binge eating. Sometimes drugs is murmuring, complaining, and bringing that self-pity friend back into your quarters. Or, you know what I'm saying? Or anger or violence or whatever. Different people have different ways of expressing those go-tos. But God said, I want to be your go-to. Before you go to that, go to me. Give me a chance. Let me help you. I'm a very present help in the time when you need me. I'm already waiting on you to call for help, because did I not tell you before you call on me, I would answer, and I will show you great mighty things that you're not aware of. Just because you're not aware of them don't mean they don't exist. It just means right now you can't benefit from that because you don't know about it. That's why he said you shall know the truth, and it's the truth that you know which will make you liberated. Christ has set us free. In Galatians, he says, don't go and get back entangled with that yoke of bondage. But let me just bring it back home for some people. Slow down. Let's just take one thing at a time. Maybe you want to give, I know we want to fast and give our whole life to the Lord, but right now you might just say, Lord, you know, what's the thing that you want from me right now? You said you want my time, but what does that look like? How do you want my time? Can you give me wisdom? How can I best serve you with my time? You know what I mean? Instead of like giving up everything you do in time, maybe he'll say right now, you know, I just want the bottle, you know? Like when you normally go to the bottle, can we just replace that? Let's take a walk and let's pray in the spirit. Let's just talk. Put your worship on and just worship me for 30 minutes. You know what I mean? You got to, with anything we're trying to build a lifestyle out of, you got to start in increments. And I'm not saying shrink your increments. I'm saying if you're already at a level, then see how faithful you can maintain that level. And if you've been at that level for a while, then you want to begin to push a little bit to increase the levels, you know? But it's like, if you've never fasted before, then I don't want you to go on a 40-day fast or not even a 3-day fast. I probably don't even want you to start a 1-day fast. I probably want you to go from 9 to 5, just do fluids, spend that time at lunch in prayer that you would normally, you know, go eat, or that afternoon snack, take a little 15-minute walk and pray in the spirit. You're just replacing those little meals with a spiritual meal. That's it. And for some of us, it's not even food. Some of us need to fast social media. You can't even put your phone down. Every 5 seconds, bing, oh, my God, who is it? It's nothing, you know, because you're still, look at that. You're still seeking for the value of your identity in a Facebook post or Instagram like or some kind of virtual like identity. I want you to have, you could have a million likes. I'll be on your page clapping for you too. But I would wonder in my heart, how many of those people can you really call when you need something? How many of them can go to heaven for you and get a real word? Out of those million followers, how many real friends do you have in the mix? So I just rather build a slow and steady core of connecting with quality people. And quality people will produce quality people. All of you that are listening, if you're connected with me, my wife, this house, it's a clear sign that you're a quality person. And by the Spirit of God, you're going to attract many more quality people. All I ask is that you ask the Holy Spirit more than you ever have before in this time for ultra discernment, because many quality people that you meet aren't going to come prepackaged in the quality look. You're going to have to dig to unearth those God-given qualities that He's placed in His beautiful children. And it's going to be part of your job to excavate and to unearth the depth of their beauty as you stay planted in a place where God can excavate and unlock yours. And that's all I have to say about that. Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you for your people. Thank you for your angels. Thank you that you are a real God in real time, who really cares, who really moves, who really feels the heart of your people's pain and compassion. And you come down to visit them and to help them and to bless them and to change them and to usher us into the dawning of a new era, as the glory of the Lord is being just poured over this earth like tidal waves and ripples and earthquakes and tsunamis of glory. Hurricanes and tornadoes of glory are invading the earth. Angels are coming through the portals and they're invading this earth for the glory of God. What a glorious time to live in. What a great time to be alive, and what honor and trust and the timing that you chose for us to be born in at this time in the earth. I just thank you so much for what you're doing to and through your people. We bless you, and we are so privileged to be a part of this time of existence as you're manifesting the greatest move ever seen upon the earth of God to man, culminating all the moves of the past, mixing in with the new things you're doing now. It is beautiful. It is marvelous. It is holy. It is glorious in our sight. I thank you for angels on assignment. Even as I speak, by your stripes, they were healed. I released the finished work of Christ, the blood of Jesus, the cross of Calvary. I release the healing balm of Gilead upon your people. Every ailment, every infirmity, every mental, emotional, physical infirmity, I declare the health of Christ over their minds, over their lives, over their livelihoods, over their children, over their thought life. We just tear down those rooms of darkness that have been dark for so long, but now we turn on the light switch of Christ in that room of their mind. Cause them not to be afraid to go to you with their troubles. For you said we can come boldly before you to the throne of grace to find mercy and grace to help in a time of need. You are present help. You've given us the gift of relationship. You were already aware of where we were before you found us. And so even now you love us much more as family, Father God. Thank you for closeness and the right to closeness. May each one take advantage of their privilege. May they not waste their time on frivolities and things that do not satisfy and do not fill. But I pray for an appetite for that bread which sustains, and that water of life which fills the parched soul and the depleted spirit. Father God, show them the value that you've made available to each one of them in our relationship. It's so beautiful. It's so wonderful. I thank you. I thank you for a greater level of closeness for each person with the Lord, a greater level of intimacy, less fear, and more holy lion bold faith to enter into the throne room because of the access you've given us. And Jesus, cause us not to play in the dirt and play in the mud. Cause us to draw a line in the sand, Lord, and make some adult decisions. For you said, when I was a child, I spoke, act, and understood as a child, Paul said, but when I became a man, I made a grown decision to put away elementary things. Cause us, Lord, to truly move forward this year and this season, even as I see the download of the rainbow all over the place. Your graces are falling. What a time to live in. What a privilege and an honor to worship at your throne. Bless your people. Bless your people. Acacia. It's like those Acacia. That's an interesting name, but the Lord knows your name. He loves you so much, and God favors you. Amina. The Lord sees your wounds, and he knows your name. And I see him reaching down with his right hand into your heart and plucking the pain out. He's being very careful with it and very gentle. Amina. It's like I hear Demina as well, too. But Amina. The Lord knows your name. Sheldon. The Lord loves Sheldon. The Lord loves you, Sheldon. Bless you. Sheldon. I heard Sherman. Wait, Sheldon. Thank you, Lord. Thurman. The Lord loves you. The Lord knows your name. And the power of God go over you, Thurman. In Jesus' name. Whoa. Delisa. The Lord loves you. The Lord knows your name. Max. But it's like I heard Maximus. But Max. Maximus. Max. The Lord is remembering you. The Lord loves you. The Lord knows your name. The Lord is calling you back to relationship. Maximus. To intimacy. Some things have hit you and hurt you. But he's calling you home. He wants to heal you. Hallelujah. And may the Lord answer every prayer of yours. May the Lord minister to your needs. May the Lord fill you up and unlock your heart like never before. To know him, to love him, and to believe his vision, to believe his